But more importantly, why you're here. And I just want to say what a true pleasure it is to host Heather Ann Thompson here tonight at Politics is Prose. She has written a big book. You can see that it's big, and big in every sense of the word. It's big in size, big in scope, big in subject matter, and hopefully just as big in its impact, and that would be in definitively correcting the historical record about one of the great American tragedies of the last half century. The book is called Blood in the Water, The Attica Prison Uprising of 1971 and Its Legacy. Those of you who are old enough will remember that on September 9th, 1971, 1,300 prisoners at the Attica Correctional Facility in New York State rebelled in a protest of prison conditions and took over the entire facility. The authorities negotiated with them for 4 days, and then on September 13th, 1971, which happens to be exactly 45 years ago today, they sent in heavily armed guards and troopers to regain control of the prison by force. 39 people died in the gunfire. Hundreds were wounded. Retaliations against prisoners followed. And over the next 4+ decades, the only people ever prosecuted were the prisoners themselves, but not a single prison or government official. Heather Ann Thompson's book, 10 Years of Research and Writing in the Making, is the first comprehensive account of the uprising, its violent denouement, and its searing repercussions. Now, you have to appreciate that to get to the truth about Attica meant getting beyond government obstruction that prevented the full story from ever being told. So the author immersed herself in legal, state, federal, prison, and personal records, some never seen, located in archives, governmental institutions, and various individual collections around the country and the world. And in so doing, she was seeking to recapture the full, dramatic, gripping, multifaceted, complex, and needless to say, extremely important story that was Attica. And did she ever succeed? This is an extraordinary book. It's an essential contribution to our nation's history, one that would be welcome at any time, but never more so than today. As how many New York Times reviews have there been? Five? As one of the five reviews in the New York Times said, not all works of history have something to say so directly to the present. But Blood in the Water, which deals with racial conflict, mass incarceration, police brutality, and dissembling politicians, reads like it was special ordered for the sweltering summer of 2016. Heather is an historian at the University of Michigan who's written on the history of mass incarceration and its current impact. She served on a National Academy of Sciences Blue Ribbon panel that studied the causes and consequences of mass incarceration in the United States and has given congressional staff briefings on this subject. She's also been an author and editor of two previous books. And I just want to say that we are especially delighted, and I'm especially delighted as a longtime 49ers fan, that she will be in conversation tonight with Colin Kaepernick. That's not really true. As close as we could get to Colin Kaepernick. She will be in conversation with one of our truly most welcome presences in this store, one of our favorite people, Michael Eric Dyson. Now, I'm sure many of you know him. He wears many hats in the Washington literary, political, and intellectual universe. He's a best-selling author, frequent guest panelists for us at store events, and he is tonight also a wonderful interviewer. And I just have to say also, we really appreciate what a great customer you are. He does get his books at P&P. We really appreciate that. He's also, of course, a Georgetown professor, an ordained minister, a media commentator, an extraordinarily inspiring speaker. His latest book, The Black Presidency, assesses the tenure of President Obama. It is such a pleasure to have you, Michael. Thank you for doing this, and it is such an honor to have you with us tonight. Congratulations, and welcome to Politics and Prose. All
right. Ready for some football?
Wow. After last night, yes.
The 49ers won last night.
Wow. Well, what an honor it is to be here with the magnificent, the brilliant, and the amazing Professor Heather Ann Thompson, my homegirl from Detroit. So, Detroit, stand up. Are you on the west side? Where were you? West side? West side what? The D. The only side. But what an extraordinary work of art this book is. And I say that with the highest regard for the historical profession so that historiography at its best is a conception of a possible interpretation matched to facts that are often denied in the midst of a culture that is invested in amnesia. And what this book does is excavate those facts, tells the truth about an extraordinary period in our nation's history. And this book couldn't be more on time in terms of all the issues that we're dealing with right now. Police brutality, over-incarceration of African-American people, the criminal justice system in need of deep and profound reform, and the deep divisions in this country over the issue of race. Though it's much more complicated than black and white has been the major artery through which the blood of bigotry has flowed throughout the body politic in this history's, in this nation's history. So this novelistic, magisterial tome of a historical work, and that ain't no exaggeration. When you read this book, if you haven't already, it is so beautifully, achingly, hauntingly written because there is blood on every page. The blood of her effort, the blood of the historical trajectory and journey, the denial of this case and opening the vaults of history as she has done, seizing the opportunity to tell this narrative. So I just want to thank you. First of all, Professor Thompson, now at the University of Michigan, back home, at the crib. forgive her for going for Cass Tech, but that's another story, internal. But first of all, congratulations. Not only five different articles in the New York Times, people struggle to get one in a lifetime. And you got five on one book within the space of, I don't know, 5 days, 10 days. It's just extraordinary and all glowing. Right, it's one thing to get, you're grateful if the New York Times mentions your name as it casts aspersion against you. Thank God they dissed me with such eloquence. Oh my God. But to see what has been said about this book is remarkable. And it just got sold, the book rights to a film. I want to play myself in that film, which means I won't appear. but let's start with something. I know this sounds maybe trite to some, and but it's interesting. You dedicate this book to the men who perished on that day. And as we've been already told, this anniversary, this is also the 20th anniversary of the death of Tupac Shakur. Mm-hmm. Not unrelated in a broader sense. His mother, part of the Panther 21 in New York, and so on. As a historian, dedicating the book to those men, what does that signify? What does that mean?
Well, I think it's a tell as to what I wanted to accomplish in the book, which mm-hmm. was, of course, to rescue the history that the state of New York was so determined to not have told, mm-hmm. but also to really rescue the stories of the survivors. And in that dedication, some of you, you'll see the names of the dead are listed alphabetically, and the hostages and the prisoners are all mixed up. Mm-hmm. And that's actually quite controversial because even today at Attica, the stone that honors the dead is only the hostages, who of course need to be honored. Mm-hmm. But I wanted this book to be a reckoning of all those people who not only were shot to death, brutally and for no reason, but also the end of that dedication is to all who were scarred yeah. and maimed at Attica, and I say a list too long to recount here, mm-hmm. because I even looking out in this group, you all should know that we have the daughter of one of the most important Attica judges here, who's a fellow historian and dear friend of mine. We have other Attica lawyers here who were there from the beginning, mm-hmm. and this story traumatized a generation.
Yeah, absolutely. So, look, it happened in as much a public light as possible. It's not that the story wasn't known, that is, that it existed. Mm-hmm. It is not that big players, from Richard Nixon to Rockefeller, and you expose this, and you expose how Nixon wanted Rockefeller to, you know, be able to get some credit so he could get some credit so he would owe him. Why is it that such a public event? Because to me, this book is also about the sociology of knowledge, yep, about who gets to know what. Why in the world was it so difficult to tell this story, to take 10 years of your precious life to really pour through these records? Tell us, give us a sense of what forces were at work to prevent a full reckoning of the historical record here.
Well, that's a great question, because there were two forces at work, and both equally determined. One of the forces at work was the state. And from the day of the retaking, actually before the retaking, from the day that the prison erupts, the state has a vested interest in making sure that this is shut down as quickly as possible. And when shutting it down meant unbelievable carnage, the next step was to make sure that nobody who had committed atrocities was held accountable. And that took work. Mm-hmm. And part of the work of doing that included shutting down the records quite actively. Part of the work of doing that meant denying that what had happened had happened. Bear in mind that nearly 600 troopers in law enforcement go in, they commit the atrocities, but then the state steps out in front of the prison and announces that the prisoners have killed the hostages. Mm-hmm. And as a historian, I'm often, you know, I just marvel at what that meant. It meant that that story went out on the front page of the New York Times, the LA Times, the AP, which meant that it was in every small town newspaper in America. And from that moment, they began to control the narrative of mm-hmm. Attica, that all that went wrong there was down to the prisoners, number one. Mm-hmm. And then it only prosecuted the prisoners, mm-hmm. indicted 62. Which sent another message to America that all that was wrong with Attica was down to the prisoners. So it took work to shut down that story and to create that narrative. But as depressing as I think people will find this book, it is also an incredible David and Goliath story of resistance. I mean, this is a story of people who are equally determined that they would tell their stories. And it takes them literally, in the case of the prisoners, 30 years, in the case of the hostages, 40 years, to get their stories out, too.
Right. Well, usually, this kind of thing is relegated to conspiracy theory.
Right.
Oh, you're making this up. You're generating all kinds of, you know, unnecessary drama around what is essentially a shut and closed case. We know what happened. So you had to pry open, so to speak, those narratives and to get at it. Why is it that the state is so heavily invested in denying any legitimacy of the claims against it, number one, but also of going to such extents to delegitimize the very people who were ultimately the victims?
Well, there's an immediate reason and a much broader kind of guttural reason. The immediate reason is that 39 people were killed at Attica as a result of law enforcement bullets. They didn't have guns. Mm-hmm. They weren't resisting. The evidence is clear. They were already felled by a gas that was actually a powder that stuck to their nasal passages, rendered them unable to move. And those people have never been held accountable. There's no statute of limitations on murder. And there's every possibility still, at least presumably, for civil rights cases. So there's a very immediate reason to shut this story down. But I think, you know, I think that your work and mine would agree on this. There's a much deeper reason, which is a sense that the most marginalized people in society don't have a right to be victims. They don't have a right to claim that status of victim. And so the only victims in this scenario cannot be victims because they are prisoners.
Right.
And yet my story documents how many of them, for example, at Attica were there. They were 19-year-old parole violators. Mm-hmm. Or they were there. There was an enormous number of guys there on burglary charges because of drug addictions. And so the story of Attica is really an inversion of who are victims, who are perpetrators. So there's very deep investment in this story, I think. Mm-hmm.
And while it was unfolding, you make this very clear. I don't think it was necessarily clear before your book that a lot of invested and interested parties wanted to be informed about what was going on blow by blow, so to speak. I mean, of course, this is before Twitter, right, and before Facebook, right, and before social media, but they had their sources and were being informed. So tell us about that, first of all, the CIA, the FBI, whoever. What is the point of knowing? Is the predicate for intervention subsequently? Is it already knowing that they're going to clean up the mess, so to speak, historically, so that they can change the narrative? Tell us, give us a sense of why that's the case.
Well, it's so interesting. I'm a historian of the 1960s. You know, I already knew, you know, well-versed in COINTELPRO and well-versed in the FBI. And I have to say that when I got the FBI files in Attica, even I was a bit taken aback. Wow. Imagine this is a tiny town in upstate New York. Tiny. This is a state correctional facility, right? It's not federal. It's relatively small. And from the minute Attica happens, teletypes are going from that tiny town to the local FBI or the Buffalo FBI, but then all the way up, and this is what Mike is alluding to the Army, the Navy, the Marines, the Attorney General, the President of the United States, the Vice President, the Director of the CIA. And that really said something to me about this moment in history and exactly what was at stake. Mm-hmm. That it wasn't just a matter of, here are some demands, can we or can we not meet them? This was a moment when at the very core what was at stake was who had power and who was going to be able to determine the future of the nation.
Mm-hmm. And Governor Rockefeller and his administration knew the deal as well, right? I mean, you this is, to me, just rather dramatic, because Rockefeller, deservedly so, as a something that doesn't even exist anymore, a liberal Republican. What in the hell is that? It's nearly an oxymoronic statement. But in the context of the times, right, his work with Martin Luther King Jr., his support for certain elements of the civil rights movement, but when the rubber meets the road, when now the politics of respectability are at play, and these are the wrong kind of black people who will not be protected even in their own society, in their own community, already marked, already stigmatized. But the governor it's no surprise that he would risk their lives, but it is interesting that he would also risk the lives of employees, guards and the like, by insisting that the prison be retaken. I mean, give us a sense.
One of the greatest long-term stories that was given about Attica was that it was a tragedy that hostages were killed, to be sure, but that was an unintended consequence of the retaking. Indeed, that they had tried everything imaginable to prevent the death of the hostages. And, historians don't get very many great days where you find those documents and you just sort of take a moment and wonder where your Xerox machine is to make sure someone doesn't take your document. But that was one of those days, because it was very clear to me from what I was reading that they not only knew that they were gonna kill the hostages, but they discussed it. And that even though high-level people at Attica were saying, whatever you do, don't come in with force because it's going to be a massacre, it could not have been spelled out more clearly. Mm. And they come in anyway, and they knew they were going to kill the hostages. And that, in some respects, at least for those who still live in upstate New York, I mean, that's a game changer, because that really does mean that it wasn't just an accident. Those people weren't just swindled after the fact.
Right.
It was known that they were going to die.
Well, you also talk about the fact that badges are removed, personal weapons are brought in. I mean, all this kind of subterfuge and the shenanigans that are going on, the purpose of which is
protecting law enforcement.
Right.
I could never have predicted, it actually took me 13 years to finish this book, for many of my friends here are going, yeah, we know. And I could have never predicted when this book would come out how timely the discussion would be. But this issue about law enforcement accountability, one of the messages of Attica is that today, for example, when law enforcement does not get indicted after the killing of an unarmed citizen, I think much of the nation assumes, well, there just must not have been any evidence. Or if they are indicted, as the case of Baltimore, but don't get convicted, mm-hmm. the assumption is, well, then, again, there must not have been a crime or there must not have been evidence. The really kind of just humbling part of the Attica story is These guys were protected at the highest levels. Right. I have the evidence. There were meetings at the pool house of Rockefeller between the head of the state police that had retaken the prison, the head of the Attica investigation charged with investigating who committed crimes at Attica, and Rockefeller's guys. They all met over a series of three long weekends in the pool house.
Right.
I can just picture this. And essentially got their story straight. And not only that, the highest levels of the state police were removing photographs, splicing film. They knew of one law enforcement officer who actually killed a prisoner. They knew it. They knew it was unjustified, and they made him resign a day after the rebellion. All of this is news. And yeah. It is news only because, again, in one of these historically amazing moments for historians, I found records that I was not supposed to see.
So, okay, a couple things. How did you get those records, number one? Like, we know you're, you know, an investigative monster, and you're poring over those records. Anybody who's read your book on Detroit, a phenomenal book that I've used and taught. But how you got those records? Did you literally stumble upon them? Did one thing lead to the other? And then, perhaps the most controversial thing in your book, among multiple and competing and rival controversies, is the fact that you name names. Give us a sense.
Well, so to the first point, it was literally the case that I was able to do a lot with this book thanks to the survivors. Again, the lawyers who had kept these records, the survivors. I would be in someone's house. I will never forget. I was in the house of one of the hostage widows, and we were, and again, a family so traumatized. One of their children had committed suicide. I mean, the trauma that was visited on these families, all of them. Mm-hmm. And she went into her bedroom, and she brought out a letter, and it was from William Kunstler. Because she was so traumatized by the death of her husband, she actually wrote to Kunstler, right, who was on the other side, to ask his opinion about what he thought had gone so wrong, and she handed me the letter. That so much of my research came in those moments, but I still needed to know, right, who committed this trauma, who was behind the scenes, and the state was shutting down every FOIL request, and I called every upstate New York courthouse, and one lady answered the phone. She said, you know, I think we have some Attica records here. It turns out that they had been kind of moved into a storage room. And I now understand that they were probably the records of the presiding judge of all the Attica criminal cases. Because remember, I told you they go after the prisoners. And I walk into this back room. And the historians in the room will appreciate this. There's no place to sit particularly. There's no lights. Mm. But on this wall is a blizzard of papers. And it was the mother load. It was grand jury testimony. It was the investigative documents. It was everything. And by the way, those have all been removed. And so it was moments like that that I was able to tell the story. But that was, even that was the tip of the iceberg. I suspect many, many more records are there.
So when they removed them, and before you jump on, jump to why you named the figures, but so you saw them, took notes, kind of a historical craft now. You took notes. Did you get any photographs? Did you use your iPhone? I mean, what did you do?
How was my iPhone? That's an excellent question. I did not use my iPhone, but in retrospect, I should have had a scanning program. That was probably before then. That was in 2006. I'm not sure. I even knew about that.
Right.
What I did do, I mean, there were some documents that I knew I had to actually Xerox because nobody would believe I had found them. And the very long story we could talk about some other time, I was able to get some Xeroxes. And the two most important documents I found, one of them was the document written by a whistleblower on the inside of the Attica investigation, a real hero by the name of Malcolm Bell. Mm-hmm. And he was the one that basically went to the governor and said, the now governor when this happens, which is Hugh Carey, and says, look, this is a cover-up. We have evidence against law enforcement. We are not prosecuting those people. I found his document. There were only three copies. He names the names. And I also found the document from the pool house, where the governor and the police are kind of getting their story straight. So those two were definitely Xeroxed, and more. Mm. But mostly it was a whole lot of writing as fast as I could and hoping nobody was, there was no cameras in the room,
right,
basically.
Right. The names.
So there's been I've done a lot of interviews lately, and everyone comes back to this question of why did I name the members of law enforcement who the state believed had committed crimes at Attica? Mm-hmm. And I have two answers. One is, and as I say this in my book, it was a very, very difficult decision. It was not one I had to make, because I'm a historian, but emotionally it was a very difficult decision. I have no desire to reopen the wounds of the survivors. You have to understand, Attica is a tiny town, and I had no idea whether I was naming the name of somebody who could have married somebody in the family of the victims. I mean, you're talking about an incredibly close community. So I had no desire to traumatize the victims, absolutely. And even as someone who's a critic of mass incarceration, I had no desire to create a nightmare for somebody living now in Florida in their retirement, even though they probably deserved it. So emotionally, it was very difficult. But as a historian, there was simply no choice. This was the chapter on the history of the state's investigation. Mm-hmm. And once I knew whom the state thought had killed prisoner X or had killed guard Y, that's part of the historical record. And here's what's really interesting. I've gotten flack for naming the members of law enforcement. But in that book, I can't tell you how many times I name prisoners mm-hmm. whom the state believes to have killed somebody, or the state believes to have done somebody something with no evidence either, mm-hmm. or as much evidence.
Right.
And nobody once has said to me in an interview, well, you know, what do you think about the ethics of having named that guy for the killing of so-and-so when he never had a day in court? Mm. Nobody's ever asked me that about a prisoner, even if that prisoner was there for slashing a convertible roof at 18 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very that itself has been an interesting part of the way this book has been received.
Are there legal consequences to the names that you name?
Theoretically, there could be, much like years later, of course, we had cases in Medgar Evers and other civil rights cases. Undoubtedly, there won't be. And that's, first of all, there's not the will.
Right.
And secondarily, the police did a quite extraordinary job of tainting the evidence and tainting the chain of command. So I think a prosecutor would have a hard time. The civil rights case question, I'm not so sure.
Mm-hmm. Couple more. I know people are chomping at the bit here. In terms of the broader picture, this as an instance, a flagrant, egregious, even outrageous instance of the state exercising lethal intervention in the lives of prisoners, the disproportionate consequence to black prisoners, and the state as an accomplice to the further injustice of those who are already legally vulnerable. I mean, it's so messy, the sticky wicket of it all. But help us understand a couple of things. Why were the prisoners rebelling, uprising, and speaking about their situation? Can you give us a sense for those who may not know historically what was at stake? And why then? How did that moment become a catalyst for such an extraordinary chain of events?
Well, this is the part of Attica that brings us full circle to today, because mm-hmm. the core issues at Attica not only remain the core issues in our justice system, but I would argue actually are more acute today even than they were in 1971. There have always been prisoner rebellions, always. There have always, since the time immemorial in American history, there have always been prisoner rebellions, and that is because prisoners, while serving time, while paying a penance, while doing what they're supposed to do, are nevertheless human beings. Mm-hmm. And at every moment in American history, whether it's in the South in 1930 or 1899 or, you know, Attica in 1971, eventually people stand up.
Mm-hmm.
1971 was a particularly remarkable moment of standing up because this was the civil rights moment, and people had a language to articulate that rebellion. And that rebellion wasn't just about human rights. It was fundamentally about racial injustice. It was fundamentally about poverty. Mm-hmm. So it was a moment. But I have to say that because the state stood outside of Attica and said that prisoners had killed the hostages, that damage that they caused to really, I'd say, the nation's psyche about prison, we cannot underestimate what that meant. To this day, if you go to Attica, people believe the prisoners killed the hostages. Yeah. This is a moment when we were already beginning a war on crime, mm-hmm. but Attica is the emotional fuel that turns a nation against prisoner rights. Mm-hmm. And we are now in a situation where Attica is worse now, by far, right. than it was in 1971, which was already pretty bad.
Yeah, that's pretty stunning. Excuse me for one second. Finally, when we think about Attica in the broad sweep of American history, you've already indicated that this particular moment, how it comes full circle with the grievances, with the worries over what is happening now. Is it too late to learn the lesson of Attica right now, given your estimation of the prison industrial complex, Michelle Alexander, who gives you an extraordinary blurb on the book, The New Jim Crow, the ways in which American justice continues to be carried out or not in regard to prisoners, but specifically African-American people, given the welter of numbers. Is it too late to learn the lesson that your book makes so poignantly clear?
I mean, sadly, the answer to that question depends on whether I'm feeling glass half full or glass half empty. I mean, the historian in me is deeply cynical about the ability of white folks to ever share true equality and the ability for justice to ever really be realized, and frankly, for, you know, white supremacy to ever fully be put in check. On my glass half full moments, you can't come away from this story without really being taken with the spirit of resistance. This is 1,300 men, otherwise divided by language, politics, religion, skin pigment, and they stand together on one fundamental premise, which is we are all on this planet as human beings. And so in that sense, I feel like, yes, we can still learn from Attica. And so I guess it's, are we in a good day or a bad day as to where we're going?
All right. Well, it's a good day because you're here. As Ice Cube would say, it was a good day. Mama didn't cook the breakfast in any hog. But let's give it up for Professor. All righty, so any questions, comments, poems, philosophies? Professor Thompson is here to engage them all. Is there a-
Please come to the mic, because we are taping this for posterity. Mm-hmm.
So thank you.
Oh, are you on?
Oh, it is on. Thank you, Dr. Thompson, for this book. I can't wait to read it. So to your last point, how do you situate yourself as a white woman writing this book, largely about Black and Latino men, but also white men and men more generally? How do you situate yourself as a historian telling this story? And does it put you in a position of privilege to be able to tell this story? Because in some ways, as you alluded to earlier, people have been trying to tell this story about themselves and complicate the narrative, but haven't been as successful. And you got quite a bit of pushback. I met you in year 10 of the book, so it's not like it's been easy, but mm-hmm. can you talk a little bit about that?
Absolutely. That's a really, really great question, important one. Let me turn here so I can actually look at you. There is no question that the very racial privilege that this book is a condemnation of allowed me to tell this story. There's no question about it. There is no question that my ability to talk to many of the hostage survivors dependent upon the way I look. And there is no question that my ability to access some of the state actors was there's no question about it, and I was well aware of it, and simultaneously appalled and grateful that we could tell this story. But it's interesting because this story, I mean, it kind of cut both ways, because what was really important to me as well was to try to capture the stories of the black and brown folks in this book that had been so abused. And my entree to that community to tell the story was not at all guaranteed, right? So it was a really interesting journey of trying to figure out in what ways was I accessing things that someone else might not have been able to, but at the same time, in what ways was I hearing silence when I needed to be hearing something else, right? So I don't know how successfully I navigated that, but I do know that to the extent that there's been criticism of the book, the criticism has been that I've erred on the side of the criticism of white supremacy, not that, you know, that it was a couch upon which I laid. But there's no question I did, and I would never have been able to tell the story the way I was without that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
I remember walking past a kiosk in DuPont Circle and saw the headline. In 1971, and I always go between whether it was an overreaction, a hysterical reaction by Rockefeller who wanted to run for president, blah blah, Nixon and blah blah, and something far more sinister than that. And I'm sort of now on the side of the sinister,
which is
that they were trying to put down a slave rebellion. And I was thinking about the Nat Turner Birth mm-hmm. of the Nation film, and that it was rational in the ways of putting down slave rebellion. What you do is you go there, you find the people, and you kill them. And I'm wondering if you have any thoughts about that. You know, in the ways that with the slave rebellion, you know, they would find all the people and all the relatives of the people, and they would kill them all. Mm-hmm. And that there was a way that this was so troubling to the FBI, because of it being...
Of course. And, you know, the interesting thing about this is, I think, you know, you'll see from the documents, is it's actually not as difficult of a call as that question may seem, because I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but I just let them do the talking for me. Sure, Rockefeller wanted to be the president. It's pretty clear the Attica investigation shuts down when he's about ready to become the vice president. That's a key moment when it's clear his aspirations are a part of this story. But you cannot read the chapter on the retaking and understand this as anything less than the putting down of the rebellion that you describe. The racism is... let me put it to you this way. I'm not quite sure why this didn't end. The book was much longer and got shortened, and this is one piece of it that was not in the final version, but I think if we ever redo it, it'll come back, because it was so profound to me. There's one prisoner who testifies 30 years later, and he is trying to articulate what that moment was like in the yard when these guys were shooting and abusing people. And he starts to talk, and he basically says, "I was looking up in these blue eyes, and I've never seen that much hatred in such blue eyes." And I frankly, as a historian, and again, I know many people share that who work on topics similarly with mine, I felt bereft of, I mean, I had no language. I couldn't even figure out how to really articulate what was happening, because it was unadulterated, racially motivated, "We're going to stop this." And literally writing on the wall, white power, making people who have 6 and 7 bullet wounds get down on their knees in a begging position and give the white power salute. Like, you cannot, so both, but no question the latter.
Hi, Heather.
Hey, Mike.
First, thanks for writing the book. It's a real gift to the country. And also the historical profession. I've got a historian's question, I guess, but, you know, hopefully a relevant one to other folks. There have been a lot of prisons haven't gotten a whole lot better in the last was it 35 years?
Yeah, and worse.
Yeah, and obviously more recently had a lot of people finally, you know, care about incarceration as a problem. And there have been prison revolts by prisoners as well. But they haven't got much attention, at least, you know, I haven't heard about much many of them. They happen. I'm just curious, you know, was it because of the Black Freedom Movement at the time, because of, you know, a much larger, more visible left that people were able to organize at that time? I remember slogans, you know, Attica means fight back, et cetera, you know. Why do we essentially see prisoners now, you know, only as victims, not for the most part as people who can do something about that victimhood?
I think the answer is complicated. On the one hand, there's no question that things have become so repressive that to be an activist in prison today is a very different situation than it was even 40 years ago. Literally, prisoners cannot access the legal system like they could have. With the Prison Litigation Reform Act, we have virtually made it impossible for prisoners to access civil rights cases like they would have. So part of it is a real also freedom of movement. I mean, prisoners are doing much more solitary now, much more time in cell lockdowns. Part of Attica is able to happen because people are able to talk and circulate ideas and circulate you know, proposals for a better future. So there's been an enormous shutting down on prisons that is partially to account for why we haven't seen more resistance. But it's also true that that outside network is crucial because, you know, before Attica was Attica, there were a whole lot of rebellions that didn't get quite a lot of attention, too. And indeed, Attica, here's what's an interesting part of the story, and this is a very long-winded answer, but I think it's important. You know, when Attica ends, 62 prisoners are indicted, and none of them ultimately end up staying in jail. None of them are convicted. Well, actually, two are, but then they get clemency. But you know why? Because the outside community mobilizes in the most extraordinary legal mobilization, I think, in American history. I mean, it outpaces the Scottsboro Boys' legal defense. It's an extraordinary legal defense. And that's all grassroots on the outside. So I think we are in a moment where it'll be very interesting to see, does that happen? Do we mobilize in the way we did? Imagine, I'll just share the story for those of you who don't know, the National Lawyers Guild, right after Attica, all these guys are indicted, 62 men, and the National Lawyers Guild at their convention, this is, of course, the organization of sort of young progressive law students and lawyers, stands up, the president of the NLG stands up at the front of the room, and he's a big map of the United States, and he draws a line down the middle of the map, and he says, everyone to the west, you're going to Wounded Knee, and everyone to the east of the Mississippi, you're going to Attica. And they did. And they did. And part of this book, a big chunk of this book, is the story of that legal defense effort. It's incredible. So let's wait and see.
Yeah, where there are legatees.
Yeah.
All right. Anybody? Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Oh, she's next.
Here then, over here. Yes, ma'am.
I was at the time a journalist and hadn't really thought about prisons much because they're so out of the way of a normal white suburban person. And Attica made me very aware of it. And in prison rebellions after that, I became quite interested and tried to cover them. And it was virtually impossible because you couldn't talk to the prisoners. You couldn't find out about the other side. And even if you could, the newspapers didn't care about it. It was very much also the fault of the media, who just took what the officials said and accepted it. And I learned at the time that it was quite easy to have a rebellion because you just mess with the prisoners' food, or you mess with their mail, or you mess with their visitors. And in high temperature, in summers when it's hot, there's no air conditioning, it's just really easy to set things off, which gives them an excuse to have more and more repressive measures. So I think the media is very much at fault for not doing a proper job on this, insisting on talking to the prisoner side of things.
I think that's absolutely right. And to your point, and it actually connects to Niambi's first question here, I tried to get into Attica in the very beginning of doing this project because, again, as a historian, it's one thing to look at the documents, but I sort of have always been of the mind that if you can't see a place and feel it and touch it, that you're never going to quite understand it to the extent you even can. And I couldn't get in. I tried through all the official channels to get into Attica. I had all the right credentials. I mean, I'm a Princeton PhD, and I'm writing an official book with an official Penguin Random House book, and I couldn't get in. And the only way I was able to get into Attica was because basically I was given sort of the okay by the former hostages, and one of the former slain hostages, his son is still a corrections officer there, and he paved the way for me to come in, to your point about that privilege. And so, absolutely, these are state institutions. We have Mark Maurer here from the Sentencing Project. He can speak to this for days and hours, right? We can't get into these institutions even though we fund them and we trust them with our most precious thing, which is our public safety and our justice, ostensibly, right? Mm-hmm. So, absolutely, to that point.
Mm-hmm. Hi.
Nikichi.
How
are you, Heather? I tweeted. Okay, I got here a little late, so I don't know if you covered this, but I understand that there was or is a bidding war going on for the movie. Okay, and actually my question is, we know it's going to be a movie, okay? How are you going to ensure that it doesn't get totally and completely Hollywoodized, okay, and really remain true to the revolutionary spirit and fervor of the times and tell the real story so that people whose lives were lost will not have gone down in vain?
I'm so glad you asked that. And first, let me just say, I still don't quite understand what any of this means. I'm still, none of this is a done deal yet. So there was absolutely a great deal of interest. Someone has optioned the project, and there's two possibilities. One is a film, the other is a series. I'm actually much more excited about the possibility of a series because this book is in 10 parts and it might actually be able to honor the stories as they actually unfold. I'm more concerned about a film because exactly, how do we make sure that it's not the entire story surrounds the white whistleblower as opposed to the story of struggle. So I'm still very much pushing and negotiating that, and I'm starting with insisting that I remain the historical consultant, that I remain the person who talks regularly with these screenwriters. The really good news is that two things. One, that the screenwriters that want to do this anyway have a really good track record with really good screenplays that I respect. They just, for example, finished the Jesse Owens thing, and the director has not been picked yet. And needless to say, I am pushing very, very hard for someone who can honor this story to be the director. Now, of course, one has only limited control. But you know me from thesaurus, and you know that I won't go away quietly. So I am determined. And indeed, that is the struggle, right? Because the alternative is to say we won't do a production. And sadly, so many Americans don't read as they should, and we get our information through the visual media. So part of what I had to reckon with and decide is it more important, if we can do this right, to get this in the visual, to get this out visually. So I'm hoping for that. I'm fighting for that. But I feel what you say, and I'm very aware of it. And they're going to get very tired of me.
And short of a documentary, I mean, all films are speculative, imaginative creations. That,
right.
You know, the documentary, the series part of it would be an extraordinary testimony to what your work is. But to put it on film, that's a different story.
And in this case, I do think it bears mention that a lot of times projects that are quote unquote, you know, popular or sexy get optioned, and the people who are actually bidding for them have never read the book. Right. In this case, they actually got a copy before anyone else. I have no idea how this happened. They knew this book inside and out,
right,
front and back, and had actually read it. So again, crossing fingers, but at the end of the day, probably being a real pain.
Yeah, if you can get 70% on there, that's a good percentage.
That's right.
I'm just trying to adjust for expectations when you see the film and you see me playing Rockefeller.
You're like,
it's going to be, you know, it's going to be rough, all right? Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much for coming. I'm not a historian, but I've had the great good fortune to work with some excellent historians. So I have to ask you, of all of the shameful and reprehensible things in the history of this country, what attracted you to research this particular incident?
And when you say you, you mean?
Well, as a historian, what was
it just
about?
A historian.
What was it about?
What's a white girl like subject? You up here writing about Attica work?
What was this attraction to this subject?
So, I mean, actually, I mean, everyone's, I think all of us who are historians, we come at this somewhat biographically. I mean, I think it'd be disingenuous for us to not own that a little bit. So I grew up in the city of Detroit, which is, you know, why Detroit is, we share the bond of the Motor City. But I grew up in Detroit, and I was one of the only white kids in the city of Detroit. My high school was almost overwhelmingly black high school. So African-American history, there is a point to this, was American history. I mean, this is where I came from. This is the stories that I knew what Attica was probably in the 10th grade, because that was part of my curriculum. It's part of what I learned. So when I went to college, I actually first wanted to write a book about Detroit and why, which Mike was alluding to. I mean, you know, this was I wanted to figure out what in the world happened to this city that it's the most amazing city on the planet. On the one hand, like, everybody that I admire, everyone with power, everyone that matters is African American, and yet everybody on the outside thinks that this city is the dropping off point. How can that be? So I came to my history to try to understand my own city. And then civil rights, then Attica. So it's deeply biographical in that sense. But I must say, I came to Attica as a civil rights story. I didn't know anything about prisons. And I remember really early in the project calling Mary Ellen Curtin, who works on prisons in the 19th century, and I had a million questions for you, did I not? Because I didn't know anything about prisons. I had come at this as civil rights, nothing about prisons. So this was a real learning curve for me, and I'm grateful for it.
Thank you very
thanks.
Much.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, thanks. I'm really glad you wrote the book about this tragedy. And I should reveal something about my background. As I talked to you earlier, I had worked with the ACLU in the years following Attica, doing prison litigation, reform litigation. And you talked about the resistance, that the successful resistance that kind of came out of Attica. Mm-hmm. And I think that needs to be emphasized, that the resistance, you know, even though Attica was demonized the prisoners, it energized
galvanized absolutely.
The civil rights movement.
Yeah.
And I have to talk about the role of the federal courts, mm-hmm. because while prisoners, like you're saying, conditions are horrible, on paper, at least, through litigation, organizing, mm-hmm. advocacy, the federal courts recognized that prisoners following Attica had rights.
Yep, that's
for
right.
the first time.
Yep.
And in fact, that by the end of the 80s, something like 45 or 48 of the 50 prisons in the country, major state prison systems, were held unconstitutional.
That's right.
That's right. So
that activism mattered.
Huh?
That legal activism really
legal
mattered.
Legal activism mattered. Yeah. So on the outside, things did change. Mm-hmm. It was hard, of course, to change things, even with court involvement, to change things inside. And you mentioned the Prison Litigation Reform Act. They were countervailing pressures. But there's this, it's always is the glass half empty, it's at least mm-hmm. maybe a quarter full.
Yeah. Well, one of the things you're saying that's also very important, and again, forgive me for the historian hat, but I think in our own profession as historians, there's been this prevailing narrative that the 70s were sort of the end of it all. The 70s was the rise of conservatism, and we wrote that narrative for a long time. There's no question the seeds of that are here in the 70s, but it is really extraordinary when you read the Attica story, how the 70s are some of the most militant, determined, and activist decades we've had in the 20th century. So that's right. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
We have time for one more question. And I just want to ask you at the end of the program, if you wouldn't mind folding up your chairs and putting them to the side, and Heather will sign her book up here for those that want it. And we have plenty of copies up front. So please do get a copy for yourself, your friends, your neighbors, your congresspeople.
Yes. We had Secretary Jay here.
We had Secretary Jay Johnson.
FBI surveillance. The Homeland Security is checking us out. It's a beautiful thing.
Okay.
I don't know you. I just met her yesterday. I don't know what's going on. No. He had a book. He bought a book, too. He left out. So maybe we could send, we'll figure out. I'll call Valerie to get him. Let's send him a signed book. I'm going to buy him one.
Okay.
So, we have plenty of copies.
And if you get 10 books, you get a chance to have a bit part in the film.
Anyway, one more question. Thank you all.
Okay. I wanted to ask you, what do you think, or how do you think the book basically, like, what can we learn from it now at the present stage where, you know, this realization that the feeder, so to speak, for our jails is so corrupt and so there's so much racism and tragedy involved in it. I mean, I'm aghast at what I see. I can hardly believe that, you know, that we live in such a racist society. I thought things were much better than that. So I must be honest.
Well, I mean, I God knows I don't have this. I singularly do not have the answer for that. But I can tell you, just looking around this room and so many people that I know in this room, I think collectively people do have the answer to that. And collectively people have all kinds of good ideas about how we might do justice differently in this country and how we might do community differently and how we might do policing differently. I don't think it's a shortage of ideas. Again, I think it's a shortage of pressure on those who are allowed to make those decisions. And the thing about being a historian is that, on the one hand, I feel like we often tell very depressing stories. But on the other hand, with hindsight, you can see that, there have been major, major changes in this country because people kept pushing back. We may have a new Jim Crow, but we don't have legal slavery anymore, and that's just one of those many examples. So it does matter that we have collectively a lot of good ideas for doing it differently. So I remain optimistic, but with you, I share, especially after reading a book like this, this devastation of the inhumanity that just continues. So thank you for that.
Thank you very much. Excellent talk.
Let's give it up again for Professor Heather Ann Thompson, Detroit homegirl and great historian.